L'interview que vous apprêtez à visualiser est sans doute l'une des plus importantes que j'ai faites jusqu'à ce jour, puisqu'il s'agit d'une interview d'un des membres fondateurs d'ILM, ayant travaillé sur les 6 films de la saga, à savoir Lorne Peterson. L'interview sera divisée en 3 parties. La première, qui portera sur l'ensemble de son travail, tous les films sur lesquels il a bossé, l'Oscar qu'il a reçu, etc. La deuxième portera sur son travail sur la saga Star Wars, puis finalement, la dernière partie portera sur ce qu'il pense du rachat des derniers films de Disney en général. Sur ce, je vous souhaite un bon visionnage.
Could you tell us what the job of a visual effect artist is like?
Well, I was the chief model maker. What that basically means is you take the artwork, the concept artwork from Ralph McQuarrie in consultation with George Lucas, and then our own art director is Joe Johnston, and he does sketches and drawings of the various ships, and then we started to construct them. We don't actually do mechanical drawings like, you know, an architect would be or an engineer. We just take the impression of what the drawings look like and then start to build them in 3 dimensions. And it's a lot of it is deciding how big they need to be, how close they are going to be to camera, how far away they are going to be, how many shots they're going to be in. You know, a model that's only going to be far away, that only is going to be used once, can't be very expensive. So it has to be made quickly, whereas a model like the Millennium Falcon that's going to be close to camera, that's going to be used in lots of shots, can be much more expensive, really expensive, like a good car, a BMW or that kind of a thing.
What is your favorite part of being a model maker, sketching the models or crafting them?
You know, quite frankly, I love building models for sure. But I realize after doing it, you know, for almost 40 years, it's kind of solving design problem is the really fun part of it. All of it's fun. I sometimes would describe to people that I got to work at a job in which, say, 90%, over 90% of it was fun. You know, most people work at a job, they're lucky if 15 or 20% of the job is really fun. But for me, making models, it fit my skills exactly. You know, I had an art background, and I had an industrial design background because that's what I worked in after I graduated from university. You may not know that I didn't actually apply for the job. I was just walking down the street one day in a town that I don't live in and came face to face with somebody I went to college with. And he said, we're working on a small science fiction film. We're having a hard time finding model makers. Would you consider coming in and working with us? So, and I didn't know, the word Star Wars didn't even cross his lips, or nobody would have known what that meant anyway.
You are a founding member of the most famous special effects company, which was founded in 1975. When did you decide to join the project? What were your motivations?
In some ways, when I encountered that friend of mine that I went to university, I had a small company with another friend. I'm not sure how old you are, but in the United States in 1974-75, as there was in France, there was an energy crisis. Saudi Arabia had decided to nationalize their oil. So the economy was very, very bad. So me and this other guy had a small company trying to survive, but in reality we were close to starving. Not really starving, but, you know, we almost made no money at all. When ILM asked me to work on this film, you know, I didn't immediately say yes. I'm smarter than that I wanted a certain amount of money. And so I said, well, let me consider it, you know, and we went out, my partner and I went out and looked at it and everything. And we said, well, yeah, it looks really interesting, all that stuff. And what are you going to pay? And so then we negotiated a price, you know. So we didn't pretend like we were so eager that we would take any price, you know. Originally, I was hired just for 2 months. This partner and I were hired for 2 months to help out with a problem with the Death Star. We did very well, so they never mentioned anything about stopping after 2 months. 2 months turned into 2 years, turned into 20 years. One of the ways I described ILM, I'm not sure in France if you have you must have the same story, of the goose that laid the golden egg. It was a boy that had a goose. And ILM, as far as the movie industry was concerned, ILM laid the golden, they had the goose that laid the golden egg over and over and over again. All the movies that we made, that we worked on, made lots of money. Even though the economy would go up and down during that 40-year period, for ILM, it just kept going. So I was very lucky to get the job, and then I was also very lucky to have a job that was not affected by the world economy. We just kept making more and more and more and more films. And we also grew. When I first started, there was only about 25 employees. Eventually, when I left, there were about 2,500. So it grew, and of course, grew all over the world, too. Now, you know, in Paris, you could find a room full of people that work on computers on films. You know, in London, you could find rooms full of people. And in Czechoslovakia, even in China, you can find people that are working on films, but they're just doing them with computers rather than building models.
Thanks to your work on the movie Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, you and your team with Dennis Muren, Michael J. McAllister, George Gibbs received an Academy Award and a British Academy Award for visual effects. Do you think these awards are the pinnacle of your career?
No, it was actually fairly early. So I started in 75, and within 10 years, I had gotten that Academy Award and the British Academy Award. So it certainly wasn't the pinnacle, you know. It continued on from there. It was very gratifying to get it. It didn't really change my career. If you were an actor, say like Brad Pitt, and you won an Academy Award, you know, you go on to other films and make more and more money and that kind of thing. In special effects, that isn't really the case. So I didn't really need it to mean more money. That wasn't my motivation, really. It was very, very gratifying, and of course, very satisfying all around the world. I mean, how many years later, you know that it happened. People that I encounter know that I have an Academy Award, or, you know, they come to the house, and it's kind of in the desk, back in a section here in the desk, and, you know, I don't like to have it out in the middle of the room or anything like that, so it's tucked in a shelf, but when they see it and find it, they're exclaiming, like, what's this? You know, it's an Academy Award. So it is pretty neat to have an Academy Award, but it certainly wasn't the pinnacle of my career.
You worked on the most iconic movies of the 80s and the 90s, Star Wars, E.T., Indiana Jones, Back to the Future, Ghostbusters, Jurassic Park. At the time you were making these movies, did you have the feeling that the designs you worked on were very strong? Did you imagine that they would become instant classics of that period?
Say by the time the late 80s started, it may be 88 or something like that, we started talking about, you know, that these people are really interested in these models. Maybe what we should do is have a traveling show throughout the United States. It would be like in a big semi-truck, like two or three semi-trucks that would be put together, and it would travel to one city and another city. And, you know, it would open up and kids could come through and see what the models look like. So that we started talking about that in meetings. So then along came County Fair in the county where I live, which is called Marin, just north of San Francisco. That happened, and we decided, you know, what we should do is we should get in contact with them and say that we'll set up a whole display of Star Wars models. Well, they loved the idea, so we did that. Well, it turned out that people came from all over the world to see that show. They heard about it, I guess, through word of mouth, newspapers and everything. They had, I think, 350,000 people came to the county fair, and that's many, many, many times more than would ever go to the county fair. It's a very small county fair. It's not like Paris. So then we all of a sudden realized, oh my gosh, you know, people will get on airplanes from all around the world. We had people from Japan and New Zealand and Europe and France and England and things like that flew and stayed in hotel rooms and had dinners and all that kind of stuff. And they waited. I think somebody one time told me the line would be 2.5 hours long, and people still stood in the line to see the models. So then we realized, like, oh my God, you know, this is much more than we originally thought. We have to forget about the old truck idea. You know? So then we started contacting science museums and art museums around the world. So that started a whole many, many years worth of exhibits And I know for sure that there have been maybe at least four or five shows in Paris over the years. And one was in the south of France, I think, in Provence, where I think Arnaud Grunberg, he was a teenager. We were setting up an exhibit in the south of France and somewhere in Provence, and he showed up and he helped. You know, we needed help, and he was like about, 17 or something like that. And we've known him for a long time. But that's how it started, that people love to see the original models from Star Wars. Now they're proposing building a whole museum in San Francisco that will have George Lucas's collection, plus at various times it'll have models and costumes and that kind of thing in the museum. Yeah, right at first we didn't realize it, but eventually it did. I've repaired those models numbers of times. When they come back from exhibits, they need to be repaired.
Your last work, according to IMDb, as a visual effect artist was in 2009. Is it correct?
I'd worked a little bit on the Crystal Skull, Indiana Jones and the Crystal Skull. That was one of the last ones I worked on. Believe it or not, I helped a friend about a horror film called Drag Me to Hell. Phil Tippett was the stop motion director for the Tauntauns, for Dragon Slayers and things like that. So it wasn't actually a film done at ILM. It was done over at Phil Tippett's studio, and I helped him do Hell. Yeah, it was. I normally never did any horror films, so that it was funny that was the last film that I worked on.
Are you still in touch with the cinema industry today?
Yes, you know, ILM is in the Presidio in San Francisco. They asked me to come in various times for interviews, or will I travel to different cities, that kind of thing. But as far as actually making models, you know, I don't. A lot of young people are amazed. They absolutely love models, and they think I should make models for the rest of my life. But I have a lot of other things to do. I originally started when I was in college. I thought I would be an architect, so I really like architecture a lot. I didn't get to design a whole building, but I started remodeling my house, you know, and doing the kitchen and then the bathrooms and designing them just the way I wanted. Most people would say, well, you have to have the kitchen designed and built, and it has to be done in 5 weeks. Mine would take more like 9 months or a year, you know, so I got to make all the details just the way I wanted it. You know, I started studying art, so I have different projects that I do, and craft projects, that kind of thing, but not actually building spaceship models. I did that for almost 40 years and had a good time of it.